Eric Martel, captain of the Concord Fire Department, stationed at the Broadway Firehouse. And we are up here at the training grounds on Old Turnpike Road, as you can see behind me. We've got two members that are finishing up their two-week orientation with Captain Costello and some of our other office staff, as well as members from the floor on other shifts that have filled in as they can. And we're doing fire behavior with them today and some roll-in drills where we take all of the last 2 weeks worth of work of stretching hand lines, throwing ground ladders, removing victims, and kind of pull it all together. Now you get a chance to see what one cushion's worth of smoke will do in a, right, in an 8x40-foot box. Fire behavior, right? So the science behind sort of how things burn and why. We don't typically do the cushions, right? Those we do with our fire behavior days, just to give the new recruits a chance to see what a cushion can do. Guys inside the box behind me, watching a couple of pallets and one sheet of OSB construction material burn with maybe an occasional sofa cushion. And the amount of smoke that you're gonna see come out of there is sort of the products of both combustion and the byproducts of combustion, the smoke, unburned fuels, things like that. So when you think about it, that cushion there is what, all of 2 feet by 3 feet compared to a whole couch? And you watch, you know, you'll know once it's on, because this light gray smoke from most of the wood products is gonna get pretty nasty and black. That's definitely a much thicker smoke than it was. It's blocking the light out here through that small vent opening, that vent prop. So you can only imagine what it's like in there at this point. Your flashlight isn't going to help. The thermal imager may or may not help, but you've got to have it like right up against your face. And a lot of times with all that smoke that's in there, we can't see. But with this, at least I have a chance to kind of see what's going on, where the fire is, and then be able to show whoever's running the nozzle on the hand line, like the fire, you know, it's fire straight ahead. I can turn this over to the side to show you with the camera just as easy as I can show my nozzle person where the fire's coming from. And you and I standing next to each other, I would end up with a hand on your shoulder because I'm not gonna be able to see you either. So I'm either, as we're crawling, moving a line in, I've got you by a boot, and we put them in there to kind of get a feeling for what it's going to feel like. The floor temperatures can be a couple hundred degrees, whereas the ceiling will get up to around 1,000 degrees. So obviously that's why we stay low. That's where that survivable space is for occupants of the house as much as it is for us, even with all our gear. And again, we were talking as they were letting this build. You can see the smoke's about halfway down. It's pulling fresh air in on the bottom. So whoever's controlling the door on the bottom is watching that smoke kind of at the door curl back in and pull to the front of the box where the fire is. And it'll start to lift and it'll start to light off as it uses all that oxygen with all these rich, fuel-rich fuels like your couches, your furniture, everything that's fake and particle board, all that glue is just extra fuel. So it uses up the oxygen pretty quick. So a lot of times for us in the windows nowadays with all the triple vane and all that, triple barrier, it holds the heat. They don't break like they used to, so we don't get as much free burning until it finally does break free. The building construction has changed so much in the last 20 years with just better, you know, better ways to keep heat in and heat out. Mm-hmm. Like with our legacy buildings and stuff, you used to be able to kind of take a window and you'd be able to open stuff up and have some room. Now with all that rich fuel that you see, once you start opening things up, it'll light off much quicker than it used to. So our kind of how we had to adapt our tactics to that. There's no ladder truck here, but our ladder truck that staff would be coming in to do ventilation where they could, coming in to help us with a surge inside. On the engine, we're just trying to get a line to the fire, put the fire out. That's when our problems start to go away. This is a first floor fire here, so if you take a multi-story building, we try to get the line between the fire and the means of egress, or the stairs, so that the next engine can get a line above us for any extension, so the ladder can get in above and search, and we can kind of protect their way to get back down in case somebody is still in there. You can see smoke coming out of the window of the third floor, right? So here's basically, so if you think of like an open concept house, fire in the kitchen, fire in the living room, it's made its way through the three boxes, it's going upstairs and coming out, right? So that's why even when there's a fire downstairs, we've got to search the entire structure that's inside, because smoke is usually what gets more people in trouble than the actual fire. So. As the engine pulls up, as the officer, if we're first in, I got to get off, get a 360 to get around the building to get an idea of where the fire is, you know, try and get an idea of who should be there, trying to find an occupant to be like, is this your house? Is everybody out? And try and get a little bit of information from you real quick as I'm looking at the building and sizing up what our sort of plan of attack is going to be. And then just trying to get in, like I said, as quick as we can, as safe as we can, get water on that fire, make the problem go away. I think one of the fascinating parts of our job, if we're properly staffed and everything goes well, they're small incipient fires. It's a small kitchen fire that doesn't extend. With the alarm systems nowadays and sprinklers, you know, probably I would think weekly we have some type of small fire in the city. But then the big ones that you see that make the news, the multiple alarms where it just, you know, we didn't have enough help right off the bat, delayed notification, old building, whatever it is, those are probably a dozen and a half a year. You know, but every week we're going to something where, you know, it's food on the stove and there's fire damage in the kitchen, but between alarm notification and or sprinklers, things are held in check. Get the door wide open, and this is a good example, just because it's 40 feet away at the other end of the box, but you can see that nasty smoke, you can see that kind of stratification halfway down the box. Fresh air is getting sucked in now, right? It's gonna keep getting worse because now there's more oxygen, now more fuel's being given off. I think they have an APW in there, so they're gonna put a little bit of water on it. So those cans that we take in, there's usually 2.5 gallons of water in there. Water expands at a rate of 1 to 1700, right? So, you know, the cubic space that it'll take up, which is where you get your steam conversion. So we can't necessarily put that whole thing out, but we can darken it down enough and maybe close the door to hold it in check while we stretch a line. So like on a box alarm or mechanical box that you hear a lot of times for a fire alarm activation, and we treat it like something's on fire, the reason it went off. So, you know, if we can go in with the can, investigate where it is, knock it back, close the door, remove people from around that apartment or that unit while we can, get a hand line stretched to go in and completely extinguish it, it does buy us time. Certainly the live fire training, this is the beauty of our job is you can't really watch a computer simulation on it, right? There's no computer program written to kind of put a fire out. It takes manual labor to get in there, right? The NFPA standards, it talks about 17 to 19 people on a single family dwelling. So a ranch style house we're set up for very well. And our prop here behind us is much like a ranch, other than it goes up a couple other floors. But, you know, we need 17 to 19 people. Somebody's gotta be outside in the chief's car running the show. The first two engines gotta get water on the fire, right, and create a safe space for the ladder to come in and do their search looking for victims. Second dew pump's gonna come in and get a line above us. And then the third dew is gonna come in and at least be set up in case one of us gets into trouble. They're in a spot to get in and come in and rescue the rescuers. That smoke, you can get like a pillowing effect, like sitting on the floor in here where these guys are. You can almost like reach up and just pull the smoke down because it's just that thick. But certainly, like for us, when we're pulling up on a fire somewhere, we're looking at where the smoke's coming from, what color is the smoke. It might not make much sense, but also like what is the smell, right? Burnt food smells different than pine or a wood stove or a campfire versus a couch, a bedroom. You take your pictures on the wall, you take a furniture set, you take the kitchen table and the dining table and the counters. Like, everything is fuel, right? Sheetrock doesn't necessarily burn, but the paint on the wall does.
Yeah.
and your pictures hanging on the wall, they burn. Ceiling fixtures burn. Like, it's, it, as everything heats up and it starts to off gas, you hear the term like flashover. They'll get rollover in this where they'll get, we may not see it today because the temperature's just not going to let it do it, but sometimes you can get flames out this end of the box, like a wispy flame. You can see a little bit on top, a little bit of an orange glow. See, so that's coming. That's over the crew that's sitting on the floor. And now as it's getting lighter, right, we got more oxygen in there. So that orange you see in the back are the pallets. Yeah. The black shadow in the center is the OSB that's probably starting to fail. Smoke is still nasty. So, I mean, that's a well-seeded fire in there. See, the smoke's getting lighter. That fuel's burned off. By being able to vent and open the door, what was once a cushion is now up over our heads, mostly. And as the fire burns out, right, less fuel, nothing to burn, smoke gets lighter in there, you can start to see again. And you saw everybody come out, a little bit of smoke behind them. They'll take a few minutes to cool off. Mm-hmm. The temperatures in there, you know, they'll get up to, you know, 800 plus degrees at the ceiling. Times over 1,000, and then down on the floor is, you know, 100 to 200 or so, something like that. So give them a chance to come out, cool off, open the box up, let some of the heat out. So when we do the next fire behavior, it kind of acts similar to how it did. Best part of the training, the actual training, the hands-on stuff that they're doing today, takes all of, you know, hundreds of hours of book learning and videos and things like that, and just puts it, it kind of just ties it all in, right? You can only, there's only so much you can do learning and reading or watching a movie versus actually getting your hands dirty and getting in there and working on those physical skills.
There's obstacles in here, mm-hmm. that you have to maneuver hose around. Just like in an actual home, there's going to be furnishings and stuff like that, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you have to be able to maneuver around all these objects. Mm-hmm. And while you're moving the hose in place, what you're trying to do is search the rooms as you're getting to the fire room. The fire room is right on the other side of that wall, and you can feel the heat coming off of it. But that's how we set this up. And as well as the upper floors, we got stairwells, and all of that is designed to show, to teach our firefighters how to efficiently move all the hose lines and everything in and out of a structure.
We do these rolling drills with live fire. He will act like this is him coming to a building fire and the process that's going to be involved with sizing the fire up, going in, checking for occupants, and putting the fire out ultimately. So that's what the first two engine will be doing. And then Captain Martell and one of the other recruits, that one of our new hires, is going to be taking in another hose line, a backup line to the first one. And they'll be basically doing a primary and secondary search. So when we go to a building, we have an A, B, C, and D side to the building. The A side is where the address is. Usually the front door of the building is known as the A side. And then in a clockwise motion going around the building, we go to B, C would be the back of the structure, D, and then back to A. So we said that they had smoke on the Charlie side. So that would be the C side of the building, the back side. What they're doing now is stretching the primary line before they go in and do a search on the structure. What they're going to be doing is looking for people or animals or anything like that that they need to rescue. That's the primary thing. And of course, putting the fire out is always a good thing. Putting the fire out will solve a lot of your problems. So they found the seat of the fire, they put water on it.
Yeah, these are water on the fire, primary of the fire.
Now they're going to be searching for victims. What you see in there is the pump operator. One of his responsibilities is to get a ground ladder to the upper floors of the building if it's required. We always want to make sure that we have a secondary means of escape for anybody, either occupants or if, when the firefighters get in trouble. So he'll put that ladder up there. You'll see that on all structure fires in this city. They're always putting in secondary ladders. This is the backup line that's getting put in place. That's going to back up the primary line that already went in. And you can see the smoke is different. It's lighter in color. It's typically steam conversion. You can always see that they're having success with putting water on the fire when the smoke changes from a dark color to that light, steamy smoke. On a real fire, one of the other things that we always do is start ventilating the structure and getting the heat out of it. That's important not only for us, but if there's anybody still inside, the survivability of them. So you want to try to open the building up as much as you can once you get the fire under control. That's the main thing. Once the fire is under control and you've got the seat of the fire and you've got water on it, then you can start opening up the building and letting all the smoke and heat out.
There's like a campaign with the close before you doze. Closing your bedroom door at night is certainly a huge game changer. That way, if at 2 a.m. your smoke detector goes off, you're able to wake up sort of without a room filled with smoke. It'll give you a chance to kind of orient as to what's going on and then act. It also sets you up for a better chance of survivability. Whatever you can do to keep that smoke out of your room, it will buy you time when the smoke detectors go off, right? And everything should be hardwired in nowadays in your newer construction. It has to be. When they all activate and you wake up at 2 a.m. and your smoke detectors are going off and you can smell a little bit of smoke, it should be a lot worse on the outside of that door. And there's plenty of pictures, videos of where there's been a very well-involved fire downstairs, down the hall, and you open that bedroom door afterwards and the room is still pretty pristine. And then as opportunities allow, we try to get back up here and do it when we can. But it is the challenge, right? To know what it costs to staff the pieces on the floor. People know what our budget is, right? Over 14 million or whatever it is. When you look at what it costs to have the people up here, somebody's still gonna be covering the city because we're busier than ever. So it's a balance and a struggle. And then to just know sort of we're doing the best we can with the folks that we have, where we're gonna be just shy of probably 10,000 calls for service this year. So when I started in the last century in 98, we were around 4,500, and we're still running the sort of three engines and the three ambulances, and we're busy. So we're gonna come help you when we get there, but you're gonna see us all over the city because things are happening.